The Dean's Lecture Series is a monthly event where a distinguished speaker visits the Faculty of Medicine and Dentistry to share their expertise and insights in important topics relevant to health sciences, to research, and to patient care. This month, we're honored to have the Institute of Health Economics kindly co-hosting this particular lecture with us. I want to take a moment to thank the members of the Institute of Health Economics for joining us tonight, and especially to thank my fellow board member and chair of the Institute of Health Economics Board, Dr. Lauren Terrell, for being here. Lauren, thank you. Our speaker today is a driven advocate for the efficient, affordable, and accessible Canadian healthcare system for everyone. Dr. Danielle Martin is a family physician, professor of family medicine and healthcare policy at the University of Toronto, and vice president of medical affairs and health system solutions at Women's College Hospital in Toronto. She holds a master's of public policy from the University of Toronto, and Dr. Martin helped launch Canadian Doctors of Medicare during her first year of practice and served as the chair of that board for 7 years. All of it in a quest for a high quality and sustainable healthcare system for all of Canadians. I'm sure when she comes up here, you'll be familiar, she'll be familiar to many of you for her regular presence on the CBC's The National as a medical contributor and for her contributions as a talented columnist to many of our magazines. Her book, called Better Now, outlines stimulating ideas to strengthen our healthcare system, which she's going to share with us tonight. I look forward to what I'm sure will be a very engaging lecture. And afterwards, we're going to have a question and answer series with you, the audience, and the public. So please join me in providing a warm welcome to Dr. Danielle Martin.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much, Dean Fedoruk, for the introduction, and importantly, thank you to the Faculty of Medicine and Dentistry and the Institute for Health Economics for co-hosting this terrific event tonight. I also want to acknowledge and thank Dr. Jinmin Lee, the chair of the Department of Psychiatry, and Dr. Pamela Brett McLean, also from the Department of Psychiatry, who, among other things, organized this this evening and will be hosting the reception that's to follow, so I hope you'll all stay for that as well. Finally, I want to acknowledge Yasmin Majoub, who's the president of the U of A Medical Students Association, there she is, and who was gracious enough to host me just before coming over here for a really terrific question and answer session with a group of amazing medical students here at the U of A, which was frankly a very unwelcome reminder of how long it's been since I was a medical student myself, but which was a great interaction. And most importantly, I want to thank all of you for coming. It's really exciting for me to have the chance to travel across the country to talk about some of the ideas in this book and to engage with so many members of the public who clearly are hungry for a different kind of conversation about making our healthcare system better. So, like so many of you, I know that there are many healthcare workers in the audience here. Basically, my life and my work for the last many years have revolved around healthcare. And basically, whatever task I am called on to perform by this stage of my career, whether it's as an administrator, as an advisor, as a lecturer, it's my work as a family doctor that basically anchors me and shapes everything that I say and everything that I do. It's what keeps me connected to the purpose of our healthcare system, and frankly keeps me connected to myself. So when I decided to write a book, it was as a family doctor that I approached the project. Now, I'm hopeful that for those of you who work in the healthcare system, when you read the book, because I came at it as a clinician, you will recognize the people and the stories, and that you'll find that they reflect your own experiences working in and around the healthcare system. But to be honest, I didn't write the book for you. I wrote it for people who don't work in healthcare. I wrote it for the patients and members of the public who care about our healthcare system, but who have, I think, for too long experienced that the conversation about how to improve healthcare has been too limited to experts, to policymakers, to administrators, and to healthcare providers, all of whom we need, of course, all of whose expertise is critical to the conversation, but none of whom will be able to make happen the kind of change that is needed on our own. So it was with that intent of wanting to kind of broaden the discussion about healthcare in this country that I engaged with this task of writing a book. And you know, there have been a lot of books written about Canadian healthcare, a lot of reports, and most of them have centered around an argument essentially that is a cataclysmic argument about how Medicare is hopelessly broken and you know, we're basically on the brink of chaos. So I want to begin tonight by saying quite simply that that's not what I believe. As someone who works in the system, I can say with great sincerity that for most people, most of the time, in most places, our healthcare system works. Sometimes it actually works spectacularly well, but not always. Not always as well as we would like. I do think it's important, though, to say from the outset of my remarks tonight that in my view, our task around the improvement of the healthcare system in Canada is a task of improvement. It is not a task of reinvention. Let's not forget, of course, that from the outset, Medicare itself has been a remarkable innovation. It was built upon the simple idea that access to healthcare should be based on need, not ability to pay. That when you're sick, you have enough to worry about already, that no one should have to face illness or injury with the compounded fear of financial ruin. Now that has always been the values-based cornerstone of Medicare, and for me, as I suspect is the case for many of you here tonight, it's not an abstract ideal. And I share in the book the story of my own family that drives that ideal home. In 1951, my mother's parents, Jacques and Sarah, arrived at Pier 21 in Halifax with a family of 10 in tow after a very long boat trip from Cairo. You can imagine what it's like, by the way, to arrive in Halifax in December from Cairo. And the burden of building a new life fell principally on the shoulders of my grandfather, Jacques, who was a very talented man. He spoke 7 languages, very accomplished musician. And he came with these 3 generations in tow, and as my mother likes to tell the story, 3 generations and 3 trunks of totally inappropriate clothing. And he assumed this duty, as so many immigrants to this country have done, of building a better life for his family. They landed eventually in Montreal. And he began to work and was trying to make headway in this task when, after about 18 months of having lived in Canada, he very unexpectedly suffered a major, major heart attack and spent 9 weeks in the hospital. So thus began my family's experience of the healthcare system in Canada in the days before Medicare. That ordeal diminished my grandfather, physically and otherwise. Respiratory symptoms and other complications lingered. The cost of drugs and visits to the doctor were as crippling as the pain in his legs, which he basically ignored until he was pretty much incapable of walking. For my grandmother, the twin pressures of taking care of her ailing husband and trying to hold the family together became overwhelming, and she was forced to borrow money from relatives that effectively was never paid back and has left divisions in that family that have not fully healed to this day. After plunging deep in debt, my grandfather suffered a series of smaller heart attacks, which limited him even further. The pressure was so unyielding that my grandmother succumbed to the stress and also ended up hospitalized. She was basically just worn out. And my mom and her sister tried to chip in, working odd jobs as they finished high school and began university. It was basically a grinding existence. And the story ends with my grandfather's death at the age of 54 in 1966, the same year that Parliament passed legislation to create universal health care for all Canadians. So how different would life have been for my grandparents and for my mother if Medicare had existed just a decade and a half earlier? I think it would have changed everything. That story not only shaped my family history, it's also shaped my perspective, and it forms the point of departure for my book and for my remarks here this evening. It comes down to this. I think it is time to stop bickering about whether Medicare was a good idea or whether we should sustain Medicare and start focusing on how to sustain it. Which leads us pretty quickly to a discussion of the themes that we are going to be talking about tonight, the theme of strengthening relationships that exist at the center of every high-performing healthcare system, and the imperative to scale up innovation within the context of our universal single-payer system. Innovation that will serve all of us well, but I should point out, primarily, our patients. And I mention patients quite deliberately, because one of my worries, as I've said, is that those of us who work and study in the healthcare system sometimes begin to focus on it solely through that lens. It's really easy, and I recognize that I'm in Alberta as I say this, to talk about restructuring, and to get lost in a conversation about structure, which, although is important, is not the end-all, be-all of a healthcare system, because ultimately, we're not Airbnb. We provide healthcare services to people who need them, which is a qualitatively different undertaking than any other industry in our economy. And so our bearing point must be the impact that changes have on real people. So that's why, if you read Better Now, which you might as well do since you've come here tonight, you're going to notice that each of the six ideas that I explore comes from a person, from a patient, from my own patients, in fact. Because after all, these are the people who I have come to know, who I've cared for and learned to care about, and have been my window into both what needs to be fixed in the Canadian healthcare system and how to fix it. Now, luckily for you, I'm not going to be able to share the stories of all six of the patients I focus on in the book and all six big ideas, but when you read it, here's who you'll meet. There's Susan, who showed me that if we reorganize the resources we have available to us in our system, we can create a better experience, shorter wait times, and improved results. There's Ahmed, whose choice between feeding his family and paying for his necessary prescription medicines is a choice I don't believe any Canadian should ever have to make. There's Sam, whose heartbreaking story illustrates the profound harm that can come to people who are subjected to inappropriate and harmful medical tests and treatments, the dangers, if you will, of too much medicine. There's Leslie, whose example serves to highlight the indisputable connection between health and income. I'd love to talk about them all because they're all people who matter to me. But for today, and to avoid holding you hostage until tomorrow, I'm going to focus on two people, two of the people who inspired Better Now and whose experiences highlight the themes of today's talk, relationships and innovation. So first up is the patient who I call Abita. We met in 2006 when Abita was in her early 60s, and even then Abita was what we call a complex patient, which many of you will recognize as medical speak for a person who has a ton of problems. She had no fewer than four specialists, a cardiologist, a gastroenterologist, an endocrinologist, and a surgeon who had operated on her years before. She also had at least two teams of skilled physical therapists, dietitians, and other healthcare professionals who helped her with her osteoporosis and her mobility issues. She struggled with chronic lung disease, chest pain, mini strokes, memory loss, and constant headaches. In short, no one could say that Abita was not getting access to healthcare. In fact, she was practically a full-time patient. So that's what you could learn from Abita's chart. Here's what you could only learn by getting to know Abita. Abita immigrated to Canada several decades ago after an arranged marriage in Bangladesh. I've known many patients who've experienced happy marriages under circumstances like that, but Abita is not one of them. Her home life is unpleasant. Her husband is a really negative person. She experiences constant stress. He's demanding and essentially verbally abusive a lot of the time. And as we came to know each other, it became clear that Abita's health would suffer when things at home were worse. The grind of a difficult home life would exacerbate and inflame her symptoms. As her family physician, I slowly got to know Abita and the rhythm of her well-being over time. We weaned her off some of the many medications she was taking, and we got it down to a necessary few. Her visits to hospital became less frequent because she was seeing me on a regular basis. In fact, sometimes we were seeing each other on a weekly basis. And when a new symptom emerged, I was able to track it against her history, which I by then knew quite thoroughly, and just as importantly, against the stresses that were happening at home. Let's be clear, her health is not perfect today. In fact, things are worse at home than they've ever been, and she's aging. She's developed more medical problems than she previously had. But she has a much simpler experience of the healthcare system than she did when she and I first met. And in spite of the mistakes that I've made along the way, and I can assure you that I've made mistakes along the way, I am absolutely certain that by getting to know her, I have been able to provide her with better care. I've been able to work more effectively with her specialist. In fact, now I often will just call her specialist on the phone to get an opinion about something rather than sending her to another appointment in another building on another day. And the response to that kind of care has made a real difference to her ability to do the things that matter to her in her life, notably in her case, becoming more involved in her spiritual community. So the takeaway from Abita's case, which is big idea one in the book, and which, by the way, is supported by all of the international evidence, is that primary care relationships have a direct and often sizable impact on health and wellness. An emphasis on relationships in primary care is essential to making our healthcare system work and work well. Now, in the book, I talk about three kinds of relationships that we need to keep in mind. The first is the relationship between the family doctor or the primary healthcare provider and the patient. The second is the relationship between the primary care office and the rest of the healthcare system. And the third is the relationship between primary care teams and the broader population we serve. So let me explain a little. I'm hoping that the relationship between doctor and patient is reasonably self-explanatory. I think each of us knows from our own lives and from the experiences of the people we care about in the healthcare system that the best care comes from the best understanding. In family medicine, you know, we teach our residents that in the hospital, diseases stay, but people come and go. But in family medicine, people stay and diseases come and go, such that the secret sauce of primary care is the relationship. The relationship between our offices and the wider healthcare system perhaps requires a little bit more explanation. It relates to the ability of the family physician or the primary care team to understand who and what we are turning our patients over to when we send them out into the broader healthcare system. Which specialists offer easy to schedule appointments and which do not? Are there physio clinics nearby that offer discounted rates for low-income people? Which hospital has the best cardiac unit? I want to know these things so that I can advise my patients appropriately and shepherd them along through the system. And I must say that when that relationship breaks down, as it unfortunately often does in our current healthcare system, the results can be disastrous. I experienced this just a couple of weeks ago in my practice when a patient of mine had a major heart attack and was admitted to a hospital in downtown Toronto, two blocks from where I work, had a full course of care, tremendous care, by the way, excellent, high quality care. They saved her life for sure. She stayed there as an inpatient. She was discharged with all kinds of instructions. She called my office to book a follow-up appointment. And can you imagine what she felt when she realized that I had no idea that any of those things had taken place? I mean, there's a computer on my desk and there's a computer on the ward, and those computers are not talking to each other. And I have no idea that she's just experienced this massive journey through the healthcare system. I'm going to get something in the snail mail, you know, 6 weeks from now, which doesn't help me at all in my assisting her in that transition from a very terrifying experience back into the community. Finally, though, there's the relationship between primary care providers and the general population, which is the difference between waiting for people to walk into our offices and actually reaching out, walking out the door ourselves. If, for example, we live in a community with a large Indigenous or South Asian population, we should expect more of the people in our neighborhood to be at risk for diabetes. This should not be a shock to us. Rather than waiting for those people to wander in, perhaps we should be reaching out proactively and reminding them of the importance to getting their blood sugar tested. If you live in a young neighborhood with lots of kids and families, you apply the same logic. A periodic reminder by text or email to parents that it's important to keep immunizations up to date is easy and sensible. So we are seeing the adoption of electronic tools across the healthcare system in Canada, although I will say it has taken far too long. But now we have to learn how to make proactive use of those tools to actually think about the population that we serve and not just the individuals who happen to walk in the door. Now, it's an important goal, of course, to lay out that every Canadian should have access to a family doctor or a primary health care provider. But what I try to explain in the book and what I'm trying to drive home here tonight is that just having a family doctor is not enough. What we need is to have high-functioning relationships emanating in all directions but centered around that primary care home for every Canadian in order to give people like Abida the anchor that they require in what can otherwise be a sea of a healthcare system that is basically impossible for them to navigate. Now, of course, that's something that we all need. In fact, every single one of us needs it, and it's a critically important thing for every Canadian, but some of us also need much more than that. For some of us, high-quality relationship-based primary care is just the beginning of a lifelong interaction with the healthcare system because our medical needs are deep and complex. And the patient I call Jonah is one of those. Jonah suffered from kidney failure, and for years he badly needed a renal transplant. But for complex reasons, the kidney that he required was extremely rare. And this meant that he had essentially no choice but to rely on dialysis for years. Now, this was a problem in more ways than one. I mean, first of all, it was a problem for Jonah because he was virtually imprisoned by his condition. 3 times a week for at least 3 hours at a time, he had to visit his local hospital, get hooked up to machines, and just sit and wait. A regular job was pretty much impossible for this guy. No vacations, no break. But secondly, it cost a ton. Each time a patient comes off dialysis in our healthcare system, it saves the system about $70,000 a year. Now, mercifully, Jonah's story has a happy ending, and it's thanks to an innovation that did what we very rarely do in Canada, which is that it reached beyond provincial borders. You see, Jonah spent 15 years stuck on a would-be recipients list that was restricted to his home province, structurally limiting his odds of a match. To their great credit, Canadian Blood Services, which operates independently but alongside provincial healthcare systems, recognized that highly sensitized patients like Jonah were falling through the cracks. And so they launched an initiative to target those people that drew on the full scale of all the donor lists across the entirety of our nation. And bingo, that's how Jonah got his kidney. So what did Canadian Blood Services do that we can learn from? They spotted a problem and created an innovation, and then they scaled up that innovation, that solution, across the country. And it's been saving people's lives while saving the system money ever since. It's called the Highly Sensitized Patient Program. Now, a complaint that you'll sometimes hear about our healthcare system, one which, by the way, I don't believe is founded, is that because our system is a single-payer entity, it fails to foster a sufficiently entrepreneurial or innovative culture, that we end up stifling instead of unleashing innovation. In my experience, that is a total misrepresentation, because in fact, there are tons of examples of extraordinary innovation happening all across our healthcare system in every province and territory in this country every day, in hospitals, in labs, in operating rooms, in community health centers across this country, doctors, nurses, pharmacists, patients, administrators working together to do all kinds of really amazing creative work. And they're doing so without having to sacrifice any of those underpinning values of Medicare that I discussed earlier. In fact, right here in Alberta, innovations like the Alberta Bone and Joint Institute have been remarkable in their ability to reduce wait times for, in this case, orthopedic surgery procedures such as hip and knee replacements, simply by, in large measure, reorganizing the way that the line, the queue, was managed and putting in place interprofessional teams. The problem that we have in Canadian healthcare is not a problem in coming up with good ideas. The challenge is spread and scale. Moving those innovative programs from the pilot project to the system solution so that every single Canadian who needs access to that innovative program can get access to it. So that we don't continually reinvent the wheel trying to figure out what the best way to do community-based diabetes care is in every community over and over across the country as if no one has ever asked themselves that question before. The fault for that lies, of course, at many doorsteps. In the book, I talk about this as the anatomy of change. Now, some of you will not be reassured about my medical skills when you discover that in my world, the anatomy only has three body parts. The first is the brain, the second is the heart, and the third is the feet. The brain is my way of describing our use of data. Why, for example, do we still so heavily restrict what we release publicly when it comes to data about outcomes in the Canadian healthcare system? Whether it's data about infection rates in hospitals, readmission rates following discharge, the ability to access one's family doctor in a timely way, we have totally failed to be transparent about the outcomes in our healthcare system. It's only by making that kind of information available publicly that we're going to be able to identify the sweet spots that we want to scale up from. We'll only be able to know where the variations exist and where the high-performing areas are and where the areas are that need to be brought up to speed by making the data publicly available. The heart refers to something else altogether. It is, of course, the poetic locus of courage. And truthfully, that is something that is all too often missing when it comes to making decisions in the healthcare system. The reality is, not all innovations, even those that produce better outcomes, are going to be welcomed by every community, by every provider group, by every profit-oriented stakeholder. The reality is that we need our politicians and our system leaders to use data and evidence to guide them to the best decisions they can possibly make, and then we need them to stick to their guns. And finally, there are the feet, the healthcare providers who bring ideas to life in our hospitals and our home care organizations, but sometimes, let's be honest, they are also the feet that drag. My own profession, doctors, are often the worst culprits. One of the fundamental realities of our healthcare system is the fact that when it comes to participating in health system improvement, we're largely dependent on voluntary participation from physicians in the Canadian context. Some doctors just don't know that such changes are possible. Some resist them. And many just see themselves as operating alongside of, instead of within, the healthcare system, which can create invisible but very powerful barriers to the scale-up of successful projects across the country. Now, there are a million other challenges as well: finances and resources, differences in demography or geography, systemic entropy, on and on it goes. But, and I'll bring my remarks to a close on this point, if there was one factor I would really emphasize, it would be this last one that I mentioned: the pressing, practical need to get all the feet moving together in the same direction. If we can find ways to build better relationships with our patients, with the system, and with the wider public, that, I believe, will in turn spark our desire to move together toward a higher performing healthcare system. And when I say we, by the way, I don't mean we figuratively, I mean we, all of us in this room. It's going to take all of us, physicians and policymakers, administrators and academics, healthcare workers of all sorts and in communities of every size, and patients, citizens, pushing for the kind of better care that will help everyone who needs it rather than leaving some people behind. That's how we'll overcome the barriers to turning pilot projects into permanent, widespread change. That's how we'll spread and scale solutions. And that's how we can make Medicare, our precious universal single-payer system of healthcare, better. Better now. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Martin. Absolutely stellar, and I agree with you. The innovation that occurs all across our country, we're just not able to replicate that from province to province. We seem to have these invisible barriers, So amazing things. We do have probably the next 20 or 30 minutes for questions. We've given the opportunity to our medical students to start and lead the evening with our first couple of questions. And so I'm looking to see who is, okay, do you wanna ask the first question? I'm going to provide you this microphone. We'll try and be informal here. It's on, so go ahead.
I mean, I think that's a question that sort of extends beyond medicine, right? It's a question that we see in probably in every industry, this myth that hold out for the highest achievement hold on to the highest reasons for your original pursuit of your career is somehow infantile or childish. In fact, that's something, that's a criticism that gets leveled all the time at supporters of Medicare. As though it's a childish belief that we could have equity, that this pesky thing that's called equity that stands between us and greatness, of course, for some. I guess I would say for me, I mean, I'll just speak purely for myself here, and I'm sure there'll be others in the room who will have wisdom to add to this, I just go back to my patients. I mean, I just don't see how you can practice clinical medicine in Canada and not, if you actually listen to what people are saying and to what they're sharing with you, that the tremendous honor and privilege that it is to serve your community as a doctor, if you don't harden your heart to that, you will not have any problem in hanging on to your idealism. I have to say that for me, this advocacy work is also very rewarding in that regard. You should see the emails that people have sent to me since I published this book. Like, they would break your heart. Part of it is the beauty of people sharing their extraordinary stories of the amazing care that they've gotten in the system. Some of it is heartbreakingly bad. Which is tremendously motivating, right? The guy who I received an email from who said to me, I received world-class chemotherapy cancer care for my cancer that I never could have afforded, and I'm so grateful to the publicly funded healthcare system for that care, and I owe my life to it. But ever since the chemo, my mouth has been full of abscesses, and I can't eat solid food, and I can't afford to see a dentist. And do you know a dentist who would see me and put me on a payment plan in my community? Could you help me find somebody? I mean, how can you read something like that and not be motivated to fix it? Not just for that person, but for everyone in those circumstances. So I think it's just about listening to the people in front of you.
Now, we have another question, I think, from Fatima there. We're just going to hold on a minute because I need questions from the audience. I've got lovely students here. We're going to walk around, and if you don't have a card, they'll deliver you a card. If you have a card with a question on it, just pass it to the end of the aisles, and we'll pick them up. So go ahead, guys. You go through the audience and start picking them up for me, distributing these cards. We want to get your questions. It's important that we hear from you. You're the public. You're the consumers of our healthcare system, and we want to hear from you. Fatima. How can we get physicians to do it?
Yeah, specifically physicians.
I think part of the problem, and of course there will be nuances in Alberta that are different from where I work in Ontario, but certainly my sense, and as a medical administrator in a hospital, I interact with a lot of physicians who I think, as you say, experience frustration about the system but sort of don't know where to start. Part of that is the job of people like me to offer up and create opportunities for doctors to get engaged. It's very easy as a physician to feel pretty much outside the system. Like the system is this kind of big machine that's grinding away, and your job is just to show up to work every day, see your patients, and go home. And so unless we kind of open doors for people to engage, for physicians to engage differently with our system, then we're gonna kind of keep getting the same results. But of course, nothing is stopping any physician from requesting an opportunity to participate in that. And I think that, you know, as with everything in life, there's a responsibility that the system has to open its doors to people, and then there's a responsibility that people have to knock. And I think that you guys as medical students are gonna need to participate in the knocking, yeah.
So it's important for the health people inside the healthcare system to be part of the solution. How about the public? How do we engage the public to be part of the solutions in building a better healthcare system? We have a great healthcare system, but we want to make it better.
And yeah, so how I mean, to me, this is the critical question, and it's actually something that I've been struggling with and thinking about a lot since I published this book, because I'm getting a response from the public, which is terrific and what I had hoped for. So in the book, I do offer up some solutions for individual people to try to make change in the way that they interact with the healthcare system. So what are the four questions that you can ask in your doctor's office to try to reduce the likelihood that you will be subjected to harmful or unnecessary testing or prescribing? You know, what are the ways in which you can contribute to building a relationship with your primary care provider? So I try to give people some pretty retail, granular advice. But of course, a lot of the solutions, I mean, this book is not a how-to guide, you know, debating the relative merits of sunscreen or whatever. This is a book about what we can do together, collectively. And a lot of that decision-making power does reside at the political level. So I do actually think that it comes back to people engaging as citizens, to engaging with political decision makers and demanding the kind of change that they want to see. I mean, if you know, which you should, that there is a program in Halifax that helps people at the end of life and helps them to guide their decision making in a way that has tremendously improved the satisfaction of people's interactions, you know, people who are interacting with the healthcare system and reduced cost, you should want that program here. You should be calling up Alberta Health Services and asking why you don't have it, assuming that you don't have it, which you probably don't, right? I mean, so I think at a certain level, we do have to kind of create the hunger amongst the public to demand those kinds of solutions. And we have to begin by painting for them the picture of what is possible, which is what I'm trying to do here.
There were some questions online. While we're gathering the questions from you, the audience, and don't be shy to write your questions down. No question is too silly to try and answer. We do have questions that came online, so I'm going to summarize some of these. And Dr. Martin hasn't seen these yet, so we're just giving you this opportunity, and it's a challenge. So one of the questions talks about our vulnerable populations, of which there's lots. And does our healthcare system have the diversity of people in it to manage these vulnerable populations?
So, I mean, the short answer is no, of course it doesn't. And we do know that when we populate any system with a wider diversity of service providers, it is more likely that that system is going to be responsive to the needs of the community. But I don't think that that means that we need to have a health human resources plan that guarantees 100% mirroring of every aspect of diversity in the population. I also think that there's a lot that we can do around healthcare education and social accountability that can make us more responsive to the needs of marginalized groups. But you know, we cannot continue to have, for example, extremely urban and extremely, on average, high-income medical school classes, as an example, and expect to yield the kind of medical practice that we need across the board in our communities. So there are a lot of places where we could be doing better on that front, I think. Good question.
So this is the Faculty of Medicine and Dentistry here at the University of Alberta, and all my dentists have written in here and said, what about oral health?
Yeah.
Dental health, should that be part of our Medicare
Yeah, so I mean, I'm actually, one of the things I'm on a campaign to know is, you know, what do you all think should be Big Idea 7, you know, because I didn't intend to produce an exhaustive list. And I do focus in the book on the need for universal coverage of prescription medicines. I do that for a reason, because we have horrendously bad rates of non-adherence to medicines for reasons of cost in Canada. And I think it's just shameful. So that was my pick. But I think there are very good arguments for the inclusion of dental care. And certainly Canada is an outlier in terms of the degree to which public dental care is, you know, virtually unavailable in most communities, or even subsidized dental care. So I'd be interested in hearing from our dental colleagues what they think a comprehensive dental program for Canada could look like. When I worked up north, I worked up north in Ontario in the beginning of my career. I talk about this in the book. I will never forget the number of people we saw coming into the Emerge with horrible dental abscesses, who just couldn't access, you know, affordable dentistry. So it's a real issue for sure.
So you talked about two things, the access to family practitioners, and you talked about innovation and spreading that word. Just could you tell the audience what the other
elements are? Oh, they have to buy the book. My publisher will kill me if I tell you the whole thing.
The book is outside.
The book is outside. So pharmacare, universal access to prescription medicines, is the second big idea. The third relates to reducing inappropriate and harmful tests and treatments. So I don't know what the level of awareness is of the Choosing Wisely campaign in this room, but you know that theme of trying to reduce harm and trying to reduce what we call low value care in the Canadian healthcare system is big idea three. Big idea four relates to the reorganization of our resources to produce a more efficient outcome, such that we can, for example, reduce wait times for elective care without having to invest a whole lot of money. Big idea five is about poverty reduction, and specifically I try to make a case for the basic income guarantee as a health intervention. And then the final idea is spreading and scaling innovative solutions, which you've heard about today. So I'm interested in knowing what people think is missing, and in understanding which ideas resonate most with people, because it's clear that I'm not going to be the one to implement any of these six big ideas. So the only way that any of this is going to happen is if there's something that catches the attention of this crowd, that leads to the creation of something bigger than just me.
So a couple of questions here on pharmacare, and there's tons of questions here. We're not going to get through them all, but I'll try and consolidate them. First of all, someone loves your feet analogy, so that's important.
Thank you.
The other is around pharmacare, and the questions really relate around, can we afford it? How do we implement it? What provinces have it? Alberta doesn't.
So the statistics on this one are pretty, you know, they make Canada look pretty horrendous. Canada is the only country in the developed world that has universal health care that doesn't include prescription medicines. And we are now in a situation where one in five Canadian households reports that someone in that household is not taking their medications as prescribed because of concerns about cost. And I talk in the book about the story of a patient of mine who I call Ahmed, who will reliably take his pills every other day, or split his pills, or run out and not fill his script for a while to take care of his diabetes and his high blood pressure because of concerns about cost. So those of us who work in the healthcare system see these stories every day. And the irony of it is that at the same time that we have all these millions of people going without their needed prescription medicines, at the same time, we are massively overpaying for our drugs in Canada, so much so that we could probably afford to cover every single Canadian for essential medicines without spending a single penny more than we already spend publicly. And we would save the private sector to the tune of $8 billion a year by doing so, because our expenditures are so inflated. So the reason for this is because we do not purchase our medicines as a unit in this country. We have dozens and dozens of purchasers of prescription drugs, private payers, public payers, people who pay out of pocket, and so we basically have no bargaining power. The result is that we spend 30% more than the OECD average on our prescription medicines, and yet we leave millions of Canadians uncovered. In fact, it's a situation that looks quite similar to the situation south of the border for general health services. Huge overpayment and massive numbers of people who are uninsured. And so, you know, the economics of it are actually, it's one of those rare situations in life where the economic business case and the values and equity case intersect beautifully. If we were to cover publicly, not everything for everyone, but an evidence-based list of prescription medicines that people could have universal access to, and if we bought those drugs as a nation and bargained hard with the pharmaceutical industry on the prices of those drugs, if we got anything like the prices that we see in Australia or New Zealand or the UK or France or Germany even, we could afford to do it without having to raise anybody's taxes or upset anybody too much.
Buying in bulk.
Buy in bulk. That's right.
So there's a lot of questions here about, and obviously this audience has some interactions between their primary care and their specialists and the hospitalization with information not being transferred. Mm-hmm. And you alluded to it in your story. You've probably given it lots of thought. Are there easy solutions? Are there things we could do today that could help us with that?
Yeah, I mean, I think, of course, there is tremendous potential in our information technology systems to improve the flow of information. But you would be shocked at what can be accomplished with a phone call. And I'm a big believer in not waiting for huge administrative systems to be put in place. I mean, when it works, when that communication works, I was in the airport on my way here today. I got a phone call from a specialist in one of my local hospitals who was taking care of a patient of mine, and the person was experiencing a complication, and she wanted me to know about it because she wants me to deal with it and follow it up. She doesn't want to have to, which is completely appropriate. And in 45 seconds, I got all of the information that I needed in order to take care of this person. Like, that is, you know, there's this amazing invention called the telephone, and we don't use it. Instead, we have these faxes and this, I mean, it's ridiculous, right?
So, you have to talk to people.
Yeah, you have to talk to people. And of course, we can also ask our patients to help. And I don't think it's unreasonable that we ask people to, you know, to the extent that they are able to do so, to help that information flow through the system. But, you know, the pink back triplicate copy of the illegible eMERGE record is not communication. So I think that we, you know, there is a lot that, right? So you guys, there must be family doctors in the audience. So I think we could do better on that, and so much of it is just comments. It's a quick email, it's a quick phone call. While we wait to get all of the big system stuff sorted out, there's a lot of common sense that could be applied in this situation. And for the record, I have found specialists to be remarkably generous with their time when I reach out in the opposite direction, and I do it regularly. I will call people or send them an email and say, like, I just have a quick question, can you spare a minute for me? I have never been, once I've been turned down, I write about it in the book, but almost never have I, I was really mad, but I don't name names. But I do, you know, almost always people are incredibly generous and willing to do it. It's just somebody's got to take the initiative.
So quite a few questions also related to mental health, and obviously it's been in the news a lot, and a lot of challenges for a lot of provinces and healthcare systems. The questions here are vague, but basically in the mental health realm, your solutions, how might they aid us?
Yes, so I intentionally did not in this book take on mental health as a separate category, because I actually think that most of the ideas that I put forward would be equally effective in dealing with a lot of the mental health challenges we see in our population as they would be for physical health challenges. So I'll be specific. We have a federal government that has declared that it wants to make big investments in mental health through the health accord process. And if that happens and we see investments flow, and those investments flow into the exact same system that we currently have for supporting people with mental health challenges, we will run out of money in, you know, 6 months, and we will be right back where we started. So thinking about how do we use the relationship that people have in primary care to support primary care providers to help our patients with mental health challenges so that not everybody needs to be seen by a specialist. How do we use virtual interventions? We have tremendous research going on in my own organization around online and telephone support programs for women with postpartum depression, sometimes actually very serious mental illness. You'd be surprised at how much can be done by phone and virtually, which is much more cost effective. How can we think about using peer-to-peer support and other kinds of online tools to support people so that we're not just in a situation where we're pouring more resource into the same structures that we've always had. And of course, you know, it would also help to have coverage of not just prescription medications for mental illness, but also non-physician therapy of various different kinds. But we have to figure out how we're going to do that in ways that are financially sustainable, and that's going to be a tough conversation. You know, we obviously have to have it.
So, finances. There's a whole slew of questions on finances. Just being Alberta with $50 a barrel oil, we're uniquely familiar with that now. So the questions really go into two parts. One is you know, six big solutions. You probably worked through them and thought about, could we save enough money with those solutions to implement some of them?
Yeah. Yeah, so, I mean, not all of my solutions are cost neutral. For sure, it's clear that if we were to invest in a basic income guarantee, for example, we would be spending more on our income support programs than we currently do. It is impossible to know how much money we would save or whether you could ever extract that money from the healthcare system. But just to give you an example, in Manitoba in the 1970s, when we ran a big experiment on the guaranteed annual income, a small farming community in a town called Dauphin, Manitoba, people were the recipients of basically an income top-up if their income fell below a certain level. It was a pretty small income top-up, I should add. And in that community, all-cause hospitalizations decreased by 8.5%. So I like to say, if someone here could invent a drug that would reduce all-cause hospitalizations by 8.5%, we would put it in the water. So there is not any reason not to be investing in poverty reduction as a health intervention. The difficult question, and this is a question, you know, to be wrestled to the ground by policymakers, is how do you extract that 8.5% from the healthcare system? It's a really difficult thing to do. Pharmacare is the same idea. I mean, we know that there's a tremendous amount of unnecessary hospitalization that occurs when people can't afford to take their medications. Can we quantify that, and could we extract $1 billion worth of value from the healthcare system to pay for the $1 billion incremental investment that would be required to get us to universal pharmacare? Or are we going to have to talk about corporate taxes, income taxes, in order to make those things happen? I don't think that we should be afraid to have those conversations. The question is just, how do we want to spend our money, you know, individually or collectively? How are we going to make it happen?
So then there was a couple of questions and then more questions on privatization. And countries like Australia have a private-public system. Your thoughts on that? And then follow up on innovation. There's a lot of private companies that are innovating, and can the public healthcare system link into some of those innovations in the private sector and benefit?
For sure. So let's talk a little bit about Australia, because Australia is a great case study of what happens when you move from a single-tier structure to a multi-tier structure in which people can purchase private insurance or pay privately for healthcare services. What happened in Australia after the introduction of private insurance was that wait times for those people who could afford to pay privately for their care dropped substantially. And wait times in the public system increased. And there's a very elegant study that was published a few years after after that change took place that illustrates the phenomenon very well. I don't think there's any reason to think that we wouldn't see the exact same thing happen in Canada, as you siphon resources from the public system, there's no doubt that for people who can afford to pay for their own care, you know, those people are going to benefit from rapid access. The question is, what happens to the rest of us? And what happens to the healthcare providers who have also, by the way, jumped the queue and essentially exited the public system to provide those services? So I'm not a fan of that. The other thing to say about Australia is that there's a huge review going on of private insurance in Australia right now because, ironically, in an attempt to try to convince people to buy private insurance, the Australian government has had to offer massive tax subsidies to both individuals and corporations to try to convince them to purchase private insurance. So the so-called private insurance is being underwritten by the taxpayer at huge expense, private insurance, which is then used by people to exit the public system. So it really, I mean, it's a system that makes no sense at all to me, with the greatest respect to the Australians in the room. And in fact, it's being looked at in its entirety now because of that, the various perversities that it has caused. None of that means that the single payer system is such great shakes if we're not, you know, making the best possible use of it. And so I think, to me, what's important about the conversation about single payer versus multi-payer is reasonable people can disagree, but whether we're going to allow a safety valve for a few wealthy people to exit the system, I was saying this to the medical students earlier, we're still going to need a really great public system. So we might as well have the conversation about how to make the public system really great. The public system is not going anywhere, and it will remain the place where most of us get most of our care for the entirety of our lives. So this obsessive focus on private services is just, to me, a distraction from the real job, which is making Medicare great.
And so the follow-on.
The follow-on to that was
innovation.
The innovation, and you know, the software companies, the app companies.
For sure,
can they help
us? We have an institute at my organization that I work with called the Institute for Health System Solutions of Virtual Care, which is doing tremendous work on medical apps, just as an example. I mean, if you've got diabetes, there are 50 apps for that. Actually, there are probably 500 apps for that. And one of the things that we're interested in understanding is, how do you know when an innovation, a technological innovation, is cute versus effective? It needs to be tested the way that we test a drug. You need to know that it actually enhances the person's experience of their care. You need to know that it actually improves their health outcomes. You want, ideally, to know that it actually reduces healthcare costs, the so-called triple aim of healthcare, which means that we need to evaluate apps the way that we evaluate any other intervention in the healthcare system. Well, you could run a randomized control trial on an app, and 3 years from now, you would have an answer as to whether or not it's effective, and the technology will have changed 20 times since then. So our traditional ways of testing effectiveness when it comes to high-tech innovation in the healthcare sector are not sufficient to the challenge. And there's a whole really interesting burgeoning field of work around evaluation of high-tech solutions in the healthcare sphere, because I don't think we should accept that the stuff doesn't get evaluated. And I don't think that just because it looks cool means that we should be investing in it. But I do think that there is tremendous potential for amazing, you know, incorporation of high technology into our healthcare system. We just want to know that we're incorporating the ones that actually make a difference. In an ideal world, we talk about using apps, the notion of an app pharmacy. People have heard about this. You know, you should prescribe an app the way you prescribe a medicine. You know, whether it's an app to support healthcare, health, lifestyle changes, or an app to support management of a person's chronic disease. But in order to be able to do that, you need to know which ones actually are effective.
Okay, so we've come to our 7:30 time frame. I have one more question here, group of questions. We've got in the audience, I can see, high-powered administrators here. Some of these are administrator questions. But one of them...
I'm in favor of administration, just to be clear.
Because you're an administrator.
Exactly.
but one of the questions related to our federal, provincial healthcare system. So we essentially have 10 or 12 healthcare systems. Every province runs their own. And part of us getting information from Alberta to BC is that there are two different systems. And what Your thoughts after you've spent all these years thinking about this, should we change that? Should we have a federal system that's one?
No, I mean, the thought of the Constitution just makes me tired. So I wouldn't do that myself. But I do actually think there are instances where, I mean, the Canada Health Act is a great example, right, of how we can try to utilize what we consider to be national objectives and have the federal government use, at least to some limited extent, its spending power to try to shape what we do locally. I personally wouldn't, I mean, I think a healthcare system managed at a national level in a country this size, it would be very difficult to imagine how that could ever be responsive to local needs in local communities. But I do think that Canadians have some expectation that, you know, to my earlier point, if there's a great program in Halifax, that they should be able to access it in Edmonton or whatever. And so I do think that we do a poor job of interprovincial cooperation and interprovincial knowledge transfer and learning. And that is an area where I think we could do much better. And I think there is a time and a place for an activist federal role. To me, pharmacare would be a classic example of that. And I actually don't think that most of our provincial governments would have any objection if the federal government wanted to take a leadership role in the establishment of universal access to prescription medicines. We would need to sort out the details of what that looks like. But, you know, actually it's the federal spending power that could potentially make something like that possible. So we should not fail to dream big at the federal level, but I would not try to, you know, reopen the Constitution.
Good plan.
So I think on that note, if you will all join me in thanking Dr. Martin for some incredible
pearls. Thank you.